In healthcare, there's no doubt that obesity is up there as one of the major public health issues we face in modern times. By some estimates, as many as 9 in 10 adults in the US could be either overweight or obese by 2030. But how did we get here? When exactly did obesity rates start to get concerning? And when did the first people even start to become obese? Well, today we'll be going through a Centurian timeline of obesity to answer these questions and more. But first, as always, please take note of our disclaimer. Interestingly, there are indications that for much of human history, being overweight wasn't nearly as stigmatized and deemed unhealthy as it is today. In fact, maybe it was even desirable. For instance, one of the earliest found representations of the human body, believed to have been made about 30,000 years ago, is the Venus of Willendorf, one of which is obese. Overweight feminine figures very prevalent in religious paintings from the Middle Ages and in Renaissance art also support this notion. Considering how long we as a species had to deal with chronic food shortage and malnutrition, it makes sense how excess fat storage could have become sought after. Moreover, throughout the 19th century and well into the early part of the 20th, the consensus in the medical community was that carrying between an extra 20 to 50 pounds of excess fat was healthy. This was because it was thought to provide an extra reserve of energy to help people pull through extended illnesses, which, needless to say, was all too common back then. In contrast, being thin was seen as being vulnerable to lassitude. Funnily enough, if you went to a doctor back then, you'd be more likely to receive advice on gaining weight rather than losing it. Now we know that this certainly isn't the case. As with increased body weight comes increased health risks such as hypertension, cardiovascular disease, type 2 diabetes, sleep apnea, many types of cancer, depression, anxiety conditions, numerous musculoskeletal problems, and mortality. We have little way of knowing when people started to become obese, since fossils do little to tell us about the weight status of our ancestors. They can carry stress markings, of course, as well as signs of osteoarthritis, but it's still not easy to deduce that these were from excess weight, given how physical we were back then. Indeed, the evidence of the Venus of Willendorf leads us to believe that there were some obese people even when we were hunter-gatherers. But obesity likely became more and more apparent with the advent of agriculture 12,000 years ago. This is because it provided the possibility for overconsumption on a sizable scale for the first time in human history, from the availability of extra food supply and the allowance of a more sedentary lifestyle, not needing to be so desperate to catch prey for survival every day anymore. And then, what has been dubbed the Second Agricultural Revolution, occurring in Britain between 1500 and 1850 AD, with its effects being felt worldwide, likely intensified things even more to a much larger extent. So there's a good chance that obesity has been around way longer than one might think. However, the term obesity didn't appear in the English language until the 17th century. And back then, it wasn't used to estimate health risks as we know it today. Rather, it was solely used as a descriptive term for excess fatness. The effects of obesity on quality of life started to be understood and documented in the 18th century. Still, it wasn't until the middle of the 19th century that it was acknowledged as a contributing factor to poor health, and only in the first decades of the 20th century were its morbid complications and increased mortality documented. In fact, the term obesity didn't gain widespread use in the medical community as a descriptive term for health in terms of weight until the late 1970s. Therefore, although obesity most likely dates back to at least the Stone Age, our awareness of how problematic it is to health is relatively new in the grand scheme of things. On a side note, if you're interested in undertaking our evidence-based and results-backed personalised plate weight management program, please click the link in the top right-hand corner of the video or follow the link in the description. Okay, so now we've a better grasp on how long obesity has been around and what might have sparked its prevalence. When did rates of it begin to get alarming? Well, this varies country by country. In some countries, obesity doesn't carry a fraction of the weight of concern as others. For example, only about 4% of the Indian and Japanese population are obese, compared to Egypt or Turkey with 32%. But today we'll be using the US to get an idea, since the best literature surrounding the subject has been recorded there. Before the 1960s, it's hard to say what obesity rates were like, simply due to a lack of documentation. But the National Health Examination Survey, along with other sources, changed this, allowing more reliable data to be garnered to a much greater degree. In 1960, it was found that the prevalence of adult obesity was 13.4%. Then, in the later part of the 1970s, it was demonstrated that the prevalence only rose to about 15%. As a result, since this rise was slow and steady, obesity rates weren't hugely unsettling. But then the 1980s came about. In contrast to the prior two decades, which only saw an increase of 1.6%, the following two, from 1980 to 2000, saw a monumental increase of 16%, taking obesity in the US from 15% of the population to 31%. In other words, obesity rates doubled, now affecting 1 in 3 Americans by the turn of the century. The explanation for this rise during this period is one of debate, but it's been proposed that one cause was the change in our diets that occurred from high-calorie, good-tasting and inexpensive foods becoming more widely available and heavily advertised. Portion sizes increasing, the population eating out more frequently, and children drinking more sugar-sweetened beverages and less water than they did in the past. Other factors proposed are the widespread adoption of multiple technological innovations in the home, workplace and school, which reduced daily physical activity, and the car-dependent design of our communities, which made it much harder to shop and do other errands on foot or by bicycle. Unfortunately, since the 2000s, the trend of obesity rates hasn't been a lot better. Indeed, although they rose to 34.3% between 2000 and 2007, they appear to have plateaued for some time, with only a marginal increase to 35% by 2013. Nevertheless, going by data collected between 2017 and 2020, it appears that there was a substantial spike again, since 41.9% of adults in the US were estimated to be obese. And keep in mind, this data was only partially collected through the first year of the COVID-19 restrictions. Presumably, the consequential limitations of calorie expenditure and the facilitation of calorie intake that continued since then only made things worse. But to end on a positive note, even though obesity rates remain one of the biggest challenges we face in the health sector, not all hope is lost. On the treatment front, even though previous strategies haven't helped obesity as much as we might have hoped, ways to combat it will only improve as our physiological knowledge of it increases. Besides this, many initiatives are underway to modify how our communities are constructed, how our foods are made and marketed, and how we facilitate sedentary behaviour. Then, on the treatment front, obesity is being taken more seriously in schools, workplaces and communities, which is no doubt essential, as an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, as the old saying goes. Granted, although the current rates outlined might seem like a massive task for us to get them rates back to how they were just a few decades ago, it's worth remembering that in the 1960s, it was probably unimaginable to drastically decrease smoking like we have. Yet, with the combination of strategies including public health, economics, political advocacy, behavioural change, and environmental change, it's estimated we've reduced smoking by 68% among adults from 1965 to 2018. What do you think about obesity in this day and age? We'd love to hear from you in the comments section down below. Additionally, if you're new here, make sure to like and subscribe to our channel. So, that has been our video. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.